This is Performance Anxiety, part of the Pantheon Podcast Network, and I'm your host, Mark. And if you're like me, sometimes you get obsessed by a band and then find out that they broke up years earlier. You think to yourself, the hell was I? Well, that happened with my guest, Stephen David McKellar. His first and only band was Civil Twilight. Stephen formed the band in Cape Town, South Africa with his brother Andrew and their friend Richard just when the country started to open up from apartheid. The career got off to a quick start when they were offered a gig before the band even actually formed. After hitting a ceiling in South Africa, the group packed up and moved to Los Angeles with absolutely no plan. After recording an album and receiving zero label support, the band caught a break in Texas and started to tour the US with bands like Jimmy Eat World, Silver Sun Pickups, Florence and the Machine, and Smashing Pumpkins. After years of touring, recording, drinking, things finally caught up with Stephen when he suffered back-to-back seizures from alcohol withdrawal. The band broke up and he took some time to regroup. Eventually, music drew him back. He started writing music again and built up the courage to share it. And in addition to a few EPs, he's finally released his full album, Nama. It's a departure from Civil Twilight and sounds more experimental. And Stephen also talks about what the future may hold. So if you want to stay in the loop, check out his Instagram at wine_gums_ and pick up his album on Sonic Ritual. Follow us at Performance ANX on Instagram or Twitter. Reach out there or the Performance Anxiety Pod at gmail.com. Let us know who you want to hear from and support us at ko-fi.com/performanceanxiety or performanceanx.threadless.com. I hope you enjoy this wild story with Stephen David McKellar on Performance Anxiety, part of the Pantheon Podcast Network.
Okay, nice. I like it. Okay, cool. Hey, this is Stephen David McKellar, and you're listening to Performance Anxiety, and my new record, Nama, is out and about, and you can go and check it out on my website or Instagram page. Hope you have a good listen, and hope you enjoy. Thanks. Cool.
I'm a latecomer to Civil Twilight, but going back and listening to that, it's just awesome stuff.
Oh, thanks, man. Thank you.
So I've got a lot of questions for you. This has been a long time coming. We've been working on trying to get connected for a while, so I'm really happy we finally have.
I know, me too. Yeah, I've been traveling the last few months, so I'm back in LA now.
Oh, okay.
And, I got back Wednesday, so.
Oh, good. Yeah, no, the last time we tried, you were in South Africa.
Yeah, that's right. I was there for about 2 months.
Wow.
And my folks live there. So I was helping them move.
Oh, so, yeah. Man.
Yeah.
That's, you know, I get mad when I have like local friends say, hey, help me move. But man, going to South Africa to help somebody move, that's love. Oh, and my dog is going apeshit right now because I think my wife just got back. So
okay.
He's the kind of dog, he would have just barked and then be like, hey, here's where all the good stuff is. So just pet me.
Yeah, my dog's the same way. Yeah.
I'm starting to think all dogs are that way. It's,
I know.
Unless,
deep down inside, they just want to connect.
Yeah, they do. We've got a second one who doesn't even hide it. That's all he does is just wants to love on you.
Yeah, that's so cute. So,
oh, my wife is staring at me. Hold, yes?
Sorry for the dog barking.
It's okay. She's apologizing for the dog going crazy.
Oh, that's
crazy.
All right.
So, and so is my youngest daughter is staring at me now. What?
Ah, that's a,
there. I'm getting multiple apologies. I don't think he's got
family affair.
Oh my gosh, knuckleheads. Anyway, so all right, now that's a good bit of editing I'm going to have to do. So, I guess the whole purpose of this podcast is to kind of find out how you got to where you are now. You know, when you have a new release, there's a whole story behind how you got to the songs that you're currently making. And I like to hear the stories leading up to it.
Mm.
And you've got an interesting one because, I mean, you were born in South Africa, and I'm always really interested, you know, being born and raised in America. I know what I grew up listening to. I know what all my friends grew up listening to, and the pop music and the rock music that I loved. But I'm always curious as to what artists listen to that influenced them from other countries. So, I mean, what was going on in South Africa? What were you listening to? How did you really get into music?
Yeah, well, I was introduced to music was around the house, obviously, growing up and everything, but I wasn't really into it. It was more like background for the longest time.
Were your parents into things like that? Or was it, like you're saying, just most people, just it was just there?
Yeah, it was just there, you know?
Okay.
It's just very grown up.
Yes.
And, you know, they listen to, you know, opera and jazz and. And it was around. I think it really, my eyes were opened to the power of it when I first heard like Nirvana and stuff. That's when it started making sense. And I don't know why that was. It just, I think it was my teenage, I was about 13, 14. It was that teenage connection that I needed. Just something about that direct simplicity and power of that music was like, it just struck me. It suddenly made more sense. And I think at around the same time, and it all kind of happened, I started listening to that kind of music, started singing in the band, started getting into music all around the same time. And up to that point, I didn't really listen to anything. I didn't, you know.
You're more into surfing and all, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. It's funny. I mean, I also started that surfing, skating around the same time because it's sort of linked in with the culture of punk rock, and there wasn't a lot of that at all going on in South Africa during like the early 90s. So that, you know, the country was just starting to open up to the rest of the world after being in the very evil darkness for many decades.
Right. Yeah. Cause apartheid wasn't really, I mean, that was still a recent history of the country.
I know. Yeah. So 94 is when it actually ended. So like so 94, 95, 96, that's when the country started opening up to the rest of the world. Stuff from other countries started finding its way there a little more. Up to that point, it was extremely isolated. There wasn't a lot. There was huge sanctions on the country, so there wasn't. We didn't get, you know, for many decades, there just wasn't. There wasn't a lot of influence from anywhere else.
Right. Yeah, because it wasn't available to you.
Yeah. Just. That's a whole other thing. It's quite amazing. And they used an insane propaganda machine to just control everything.
Yeah.
I mean, I was born in 83, so you know, I was very young when this is all coming to head and exploding. And yeah, so the country in South Africa in the 90s, I mean, it was a phenomenal time because it was opening up to the world, and but it was still so isolated and still very unknown. I feel like now it's a tourist destination, but at the time it still had the shadow of apartheid over it, and it was it was changing massively, and there was a lot of hope and a lot of growth happening. So it was a very exciting time to be there. And I think, but naturally, we felt, and we still do feel very much like the underdogs, you know?
I can understand that.
Yeah. It's such a tricky one, you know, cause I'm a white guy from South Africa. It's like the idea of growing up there. It's hard to explain, you know, how that all came about, but South Africa's a very unique place in the world, and there's a lot of cultures, a lot of languages, a lot of people from all over the world that gravitated there for many reasons, you know. And I grew up in Cape Town's a very beautiful place. It's on the coast. It's very wild, and it's stunning. So I think it was and kind of unknown for Europeans would vacate there a lot, but it was just not like, it was a little hidden gem. So, I think that when as a kid, you know, I just wanted to be in touch with the world, and I felt like music from America and the UK and Europe felt it, it gave me a link to what was happening to the rest of the world.
That makes a lot of sense. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors. Hey, everybody. I've got a great sponsor that I want to talk to you about. For a long time, I wondered if CBD was something that might benefit me, but I had no idea how to find out. I didn't know what products were available, what companies were reputable, and really even what questions to ask to get the answers I needed. That's why I'm so glad I found Pure Spectrum CBD. They helped me discover what CBD could do for me. They were awesome at determining what my needs were, and they helped me find a starting point. I've started with the tincture and the isolate, but there's also gummies, topicals, mints, and a lot more. Pure Spectrum not only has CBD products for wellness, they also have them for fitness and recovery. There's even CBD for your pets. The website has a ton of information and chat options are available, and all their products are third-party tested, and the results are available right on their website. So go to purespectrumcbd.com to do your own research, and when you check out, use code PERFORMANCEANX for 15% off your order. Check them out on Instagram at purespectrumhemp and subscribe to their email list for sales, new products, and updates. Pure Spectrum, refined phytocannabinoid wellness products for all lifestyles.
Yeah, and so it felt like that was extremely intriguing and exciting. So I just lapped that up, you know. And that's kind of how I got into it. And then I started playing bass. I started singing first as the band, and then I started playing bass because nobody else wanted to play bass. and then I thought, oh, crap, I'm going to sing and play bass. Well, whatever. I'll just try to do that.
So was Civil Twilight the first band that you started? Because you were in that with your brother, right?
Yeah, the first band. My brother and Rich and I. It was like, it's insane how... It came together very accidentally too. My brother and Rich had this idea of forming a band, and they had they jammed a little bit of something. I wasn't really involved in that. I didn't even know I wanted to do music. I was just like, yeah, they're just doing their thing.
Right.
And I was about, 13, 14. And they got offered a show. They had no songs. They weren't even a band, but said they just had no name or anything. They just said, someone said, why don't you guys start a band and open for this other band that's playing a show in 2 weeks' time.
Oh, my God.
And so they said, well, we don't have a singer, but Andrew, my brother, suggested that I sing, because I don't know why he did that. Because I think he felt like, well, I can't sing. Rich can't sing.
Who else
Steve
do I know?
Steve might be able to sing, but let's throw him in there and see what happens. Yeah.
So wait, is he older or younger than you?
He's older than me.
Okay, yeah. So that makes a lot of sense. I'm the oldest brother in my family, so that's something I would have done to my little brother.
Yeah, yeah. So take this mic, go up there and just sing something, and we'll see what happens.
Yeah, you'll be fine. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, and that was the first gig with it. Was in 2 weeks. Suddenly, I found myself on this stage in the school hall in front of about 40 people, and wanting to puke because I was so nervous, and I was just sort of just like monotone. I was just very basically just like reading poetry over this like very yeah. I loved it though. I was in the thrill of it was amazing. I was in from the get go in terms of that like power. And then you're like, okay, well, let's do this again. But we didn't, there wasn't a lot going on there. The rock scene was kind of like non-existent. There were only a few.
Yeah, I was going to ask. What was it like there? I've had two other people from South Africa on.
Okay.
Andre Leo and Lucy Kruger. And their experience was that it was very difficult because there weren't a whole lot of places and there was a huge distance between them.
Yeah.
You know, I guess in that area, but then they said eventually they just kind of became this little enclave of places to play. And it wasn't a huge amount, but I mean, is that kind of what you experienced? Was there only a select number of places to play without having to go great distances?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Only in Cape Town, only I could think of like three venues.
Wow.
That you could go to, and they were very. The one was a coffee shop, and one was like a very. One was like a biker bar, and the other one was like some shack bar, kind of beach bar thing.
Oh wow!
So we did like a lot of, and then there were bigger theaters and stuff, but we, you know. nobody really played those. We did have like the Rolling Stones come through, you know.
Oh wow.
And that kind of stuff. But they were playing stadiums, and it was like on a different planet. It wasn't, we were just trying to create a thing. So it grew very quickly. And then, I mean, there was, yeah, very quickly there was a lot of groups, a lot of really good music happening. I guess it is always happening, but I was just completely unaware of it. And we did a lot of shows in people's backyards and in parks, school halls, you know, sort of stuff that was arranged by friends. And yeah, it's just the best way to get into it. You know, you just like, got no monitors.
DIY.
No, yeah, just like it was, and we were playing punk. We were really into punk music.
Okay.
At that time.
So how did you guys come up with the name Civil Twilight? Or how did you choose that?
We'd gone through several names. I think we'd gone through five different names until we came up with that name.
Oh man.
And it was, we moved to the States. We flew to LA, the three of us, to see if we could make it big. Right. And this was like back in 2004. And I was about 20, 21. And we went there and we thought, yeah, let's see what we can do. And we were under a different name. And then we were under the name The View.
And, oh, wow.
because we didn't get any of the American, so a lot of the American channels in the States, we didn't know that there was a show called The View. You know?
Right, yeah.
So when we got to the States, we found immense confusion. About the name.
You had
so
a whole lot of middle-aged women wanting to see Joy Behar instead of you guys.
Right. Wow, what the hell is this?
Yeah. Who are these kids?
I thought these tickets were a little cheaper. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, man.
So we thought, okay, we better change it. I don't know. I think it was like one of those decisions we made overnight. Like we needed something very quickly and... it was like an aviation term. My grandfather was a pilot. My uncle was a pilot. We just started riffing on the aviation idea.
Oh,
and
cool.
I think Civil Twilight was like an aviation, navigational term that they, you know, that's used back in the day.
Oh, that's awesome.
So we thought, let's just go with that.
And it's unusual. So it's, you know, you often hear how hard it is for a band to find a name that isn't already taken. So
I know. Well, nowadays, hey, that's impossible already. You got to name your band. You got to go really crazy because it's all been taken. Eh?
Yeah, exactly. It's that's the one of the constants on this podcast is how hard it is to name a band.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
I can't even, I guess, cause now with social media, everybody's in a band. So
Yeah.
Seems like it anyway.
And I know.
And you know, it's not like it used to be where there could be like five bands called The View in all over the country, but nobody knows about them because you can't, you know, there was no internet to for everybody to reach out. So.
Right. That's true. Yeah.
Like the old Spinal Tap thing. We were the Originals. And then we found out there's another band called The Originals. So then we were the New Originals. So you moved to LA from South Africa. I mean, was your family really supportive of that, or were they a little nervous?
Oh, massively supportive, yeah.
Oh, awesome.
Pretty crazy, man. I think back on that time, I don't know what they were thinking. It's insane faith to be able to send your two sons across the world, not knowing how long they're going to be away. And
yeah.
If they'll ever come back. It was like pretty brutal, man. I mean... but they will be, since day one, my folks have been supportive of whatever I do. It's quite amazing. And that's I don't know anything else. So when I see parents fighting against the natural growth of their kids, it doesn't make any sense to me, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. My folks were just incredible that way. And they still are. Anything I think I could, if I called them up and said I decided to be a fisherman, or whatever, they'll be like, that sounds good. You just go for it.
Be the best one you can be.
They're incredible that way.
So when you moved to LA, did you guys have anything set up here? I mean, did you have a place to stay? I mean, how did that work? Cause like I said, you know, there was no internet at that point. If I remember, or at least very, very basic internet, you know, it wasn't like it is today.
I know. It's just, it's crazy. Hey? Yeah. It's, I think we had, we thought, where should we go? We thought we need to get out of Africa. We felt like we would hit a ceiling. If no matter how much success we'd have there, we'd still be hitting the ceiling. Mm-hmm. And we thought we'd want to go somewhere else where we can grow and really challenge ourselves. So we thought, should we go to London? It's like, yeah, I don't know. And then we thought, should we go to New York? We just sort of picked some of the big places. And we thought, LA, we know at least three people that live in LA, and there were three South Africans that had moved there. So we thought, let's just go there. So we planned as far as staying with these friends of ours for a little bit. We didn't know how long. We thought we'd be there. We'll crash with them for like a week or two and then go from there. And
oh my God.
Pretty much all we had planned. Yeah.
So I'm going to uproot my entire life, move all the way across the planet, and we'll figure it out after a week or so.
I know. It's madness. Yeah.
That's
amazing. You know, you're young and like, just, you don't give a crap.
I mean, no.
You're signing up for an adventure. It's like, that's all you're ready. It was madness. But it's amazing how you go into something, you jump into something like that, and you're totally open to everybody and everything. It's everything. You know, I was not conditioned. I didn't have any preconceptions of American culture or American subcultures. So to me, everything was completely open. We were open to anybody, anything. It was that kind of made a big difference. You know, we didn't have, there was zero prejudice towards any, because we didn't grow up here, that nothing was linked to anything. Mm-hmm. Any identity, or it was all up for grabs.
Yeah, it was a whole fresh start for you guys.
Yeah, so we made tons of friends very quickly, and were able to stay with lots of people for many, many years. We stayed with those friends for 2 weeks, and they kicked us out eventually, and they said, you guys got to go. Yeah, so we found some other place to be. I think we lived in a house with like 13 other guys for about 6 months, until they were like, we were sleeping in the garage at the time in there. So we need the garage now. Maybe you guys should move up. Then we finally find our own place. Yeah.
Wow. Well, Americans will help out anybody with an accent, I've discovered.
That is very true. It was certainly handy.
it really works out that way.
Yeah, and Americans tend to be. I feel this when I come back here. It's very generous, you know. Like my experience of being here. I don't know what I would have done. I mean, we wouldn't have made it without the generosity of people, you know.
It's another, I hate to say, truth about America, because I hate to think of it that way, this way, but we're very open to people outside of America. We'll help everybody out, but we will turn on ourselves in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
A lot of self-loathing here.
I know, man.
It's incredible.
Yeah. It's interesting. Eh? But the heart of it, you're right. The heart of it is open. I mean, America is still the giant experiments that we're all experiencing.
Yeah. You know,
it's like,
very true.
I mean, which makes it a fascinating place. Like growing up, I was absolutely fascinated with it, and so I still am in a way. It's because it's ever changing, you know.
It's never the same. One day to the next, this country is never the same. How did, or when did things start to, the momentum for the band start to build here in the U.S.?
I mean, it was years and years later. We
wow.
So we were in LA for 3 years. A lot of that time was kind of waiting for visas and sort of bouncing around, doing odd jobs and some odd gigs here and there. It was like a very interesting, hard time, but very interesting. It was a lot of growth. Eventually we found, I mean, it's quite a crazy story. I can get into all the detail, but it's...
Go into as much detail as you want. I got all day. Well, okay, so
there's this club here called Molly Malone's, and we started doing a residency there, and we played every Thursday night. And one day this guy was in the audience, and he said, "Why don't you guys come? I really like your stuff. Why don't you come, and if you need a place to rehearse, you can come and rehearse at the studio that I work at." So we said, "Oh, that sounds awesome." So we went there. One day we were rehearsing in the studio. We didn't know who owned the studio. We just sort of sat up there and started playing. And one day this guy walked in and stood there and was hearing us. He was watching us play. And he was like, and then we did it. And we ended our song, and "Hey man, what's up?" And he said, "What are you guys doing here?" And said, "Oh, we told, you know, Sunset told us we could rehearse." And he's like, "Yeah, no, I don't know about this. This is my studio. I don't know what you guys are doing here." So then he was like, "But I really like your stuff. You should, I'd love to work with you." And funny enough, he ended up, you know, he was running a little record label at the time, and he ended up managing us for the next, next like 10 years. Managing us. Yeah.
Wow.
Something like that. He was well connected. He had a lot of friends around the place, and he had a college friend who was living in South Carolina, who was part owner in a studio. And he told us that if we get out there, we could record in the studio for free.
Wow.
So we had a little Chevy Astro van at the time, and we were staying in a shed in someone's backyard. And and one night we thought, and this guy that we were staying with was kind of a difficult guy. We didn't really know how to part ways. So one night we just, while he was away, we just packed all our things in the van and drove away. And we drove across the States to Greenville, South Carolina. Got there and recorded that first record, actually, that we did. It was recorded in Greenville, South Carolina.
So you, at this time, before that, you guys were touring, playing a lot though, right? You guys basically just played out.
Yeah, and this is before we played a lot, but this is before it really started to get going.
Okay.
So then we made this record. We made a video for it. We booked our own tours, and we were on a tour up the East Coast playing these little clubs. And after the show, after this one show in Brooklyn, where there were about three people in the audience, one of the guys in the audience came up to us afterwards and said, like, "Hey man, I run this label, you know, you should, I really love to sign you guys, you know, you should come by." And so we ended up signing with this indie label out of New York, and they liked the president of the label liked the record, but nobody else in the record company liked it. So we were shelved for about a year. So we had this record deal, but we sort of just sat around until one day we got a call from a radio station in Texas saying that they're spinning our song and it's getting a lot of traction. Do we want to come down and do like a live performance for them? So we thought, okay. At this point, we'd actually moved to Nashville, and we'd been there for about a year, maybe 8 months, just doing what you do in Nashville, which is like drink and get into trouble in this.
We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors.
And so we thought, okay, let's drive out to Texas and do this show and see what happens. By the time we got to Texas, you know, the song had picked up momentum at other stations, started playing it. So we just kind of went from there doing these radio shows. And then before you knew it, we were touring. We got a booking agent, and we were like out on the road for like 2 years straight.
Wow. So which song was it that really lit the fuse and what song was getting big in Texas?
It was a song called Letters from the Sky. And
that's a great song.
Thanks. And yeah, it was the one, just again, the one that the label thought was the weakest. It had no chorus. It was nothing. Yeah, they just thought, there's nothing there. Of it either. I mean, we loved all the songs on that record. We weren't really thinking about things that way, but it started picking up momentum. Crazy, man. We toured on the back of that for the next like 5-6 years, you know. It's crazy.
Did the move from LA to the Nashville area, did that have an effect on the sound of the music?
Definitely. Yeah. I think by that time we were more, we started becoming more familiar with American culture and with, American subcultures. And yeah, we started picking up a little more influence from what was around us. Nashville at the time, there was a really cool, very small indie scene there that we somehow got introduced to, and it was a great, great fertile soil, you know, to sort of get in touch with a different style. Yeah, so that really started changing our writing and what we were writing about, you know.
What was the writing process like for the band? I mean, was there a main songwriter, or was everybody contributing equally, or a little bit of both?
Yeah, it was interesting. It was like, you know, the first record is just a lot of jamming. We jammed. We loved to just like, you know, sit in a room and make sounds until something felt like a song.
Right.
A lot of it was, I started writing songs, very, very poor, bad songs for my entire teens. You know? it was like therapeutic stuff. It was like, right. You'd sit in a bed and just like, you know, when am I going to be in love? And like, you know, just the yearnings of a teen.
Yeah. And, teenage angst.
Yeah, man. So I'd been doing that for a long time. I think what I would do is I'd always take ideas to the band and not really, I was too like shy to really, I wasn't bold enough to like take charge of anything I'd written. So I would usually like hint at things in rehearsals, you know, start playing a riff that I'd been working on while, you know, and try and put it into the mix and see if it got any looks, you know?
Right.
So melody, and lyrics, those were obviously assigned. Those roles were assigned to me because I was the lead singer and I was going to sing these words. So I mean, you know, it made more sense. You know?
Yeah.
But the sound of the atmosphere of the songs, that all came from us being in a room playing together. And then it started, you know, started changing as the records went along.
I read something interesting about the second album, and that it was recorded based on some solo demos that when you guys actually went in to record it, the band as a whole had never rehearsed them at all.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And that was terrifying for us because we, from up till then, we had done, you know, first records of any band are usually the greatest hits of the band's greatest hits of, you know,
the past several years of touring.
Yeah. So whatever, it's like a refined, sort of refining of all these tunes that you've become familiar with. And suddenly we, you know, we go off the road. And the label was like, well, I think it's you know, contractually, you guys are obligated to make another record and you should probably get going on that. Can you maybe pump something out in the next, like, you know, give us some demos or something in the next, like, 2 weeks, you know?
Wow.
And, so it was, I don't even know why they did that. Insane. But it was really good. So I was like, how are we going to do this? We don't really have, usually for us at the time, songs came very slowly over many hours of playing and many, months of refining. So I thought, how are we going to pull this off? We need to make this record. And a fan of ours had given me, had used some lyrics in a book that she'd written. And the book apparently had sold some copies. And so she gave me royalties for the supposed contribution to her book.
Oh, cool.
And I took that money and bought my first computer, my first laptop. And on the laptop there was GarageBand, and I'd never used GarageBand. So I started dabbling in that and making all these demos. And within about 2 or 3 weeks, I had about 15 little demos. I sent those to the label, and then the label sent those to some people some producers that we were interested in working with.
Oh,
and
wow.
To my surprise, they were like, yeah, let's just run with these. And that's how that happens. And then before we knew it, we were on a plane to London to work with this producer on songs that we'd never played before. And
oh my. And that's what became Holy Weather?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Man,
well,
it doesn't sound like a whole bunch of demos. I mean, it's a fantastic album.
Thanks. Yeah.
Especially that, really I love great. The title track.
She was lost like a breeze in a hurricane. A hurricane. You know that I got you.
That was awesome. I mean, it was, that's the sound of a dude who's experiencing multi-tracking for the first time.
All the worlds are opening up.
Yeah. So wait, I can do like 6 different vocals, and I can put on I can do as many drum parts as I like. I mean, I wanted to just go crazy. And I wasn't techie at all. I wasn't familiar with how things were recorded. And I didn't have drum machines or anything, so a lot of it was just like DIY, you know?
Oh,
yeah, just great, yeah.
Crazy, wild, open time for you guys.
I know, amazing. Yeah, and then that record was done. We then, again, just toured.
It paid off, though. I mean, you guys had some amazing high-profile shows. I mean, touring with Smashing Pumpkins, Florence and the Machine, Jimmy Eat World, mm-hmm. Silver Sun Pickups. And, you know, some of your music ended up on shows like Sarah Connor Chronicles, One Tree Hill, House, you know, huge stuff.
I know.
So sounds like it paid off for you, all that hard work.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it did. I mean, this is crazy. It's a crazy adventure. I mean, and I guess the adventure continues. It's like, I look back right now, I have enough objectivity now to look back on it and realize a few things. And like, one of them is like, it's incredible what you can do when you give yourself time and you're in no rush, but you're just there to have an experience and focus on doing what you love to do. It sounds so cliche, but it really is.
Well, it's cliche for a reason though.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, that's the marrow of it, you know.
Yeah.
Everything else comes, everything that you're desiring from it comes, and it'll come in its own form and its own timing. But when the objective is just to like have an adventure and experience life and, you know, try and make things that you love, it's like you can't really go wrong. I mean, it and also it's gonna be
Yeah, you grow in and out of things too, you know, like the idea that we constantly want to have something that we identify with, that sort of becomes our identity. And when we're younger, you're desperate for identity, and you're desperate to be somebody, to be something, to be defined. And you want that success. You want that image. You want that thing that's going to define you, so you can just sit back and get in and reap the rewards and go into sort of auto mode. But then you realize that, like, oh, life continues.
Yeah.
You know, life goes on and
then
evolve.
You don't want to be defined. Then people start to expect what you've done in the past, and you go, I don't want to do that. I don't want that to define me.
Yeah. It's like, I'm not Coca-Cola here.
Right.
It's like, I'm a human being. Yeah, so it's been an interesting practice in, like, the natural organic growth of things. I mean, it's okay to, like, have to get everything that you've desired for many years, and then to live with it for a bit, and then put it down and move on. You know?
Yeah.
And the band was certainly like that. Like, years and years and years and years and years of, like, pushing and working and playing and working towards this thing that we wanted, getting it, and then living in it for a bit, and then putting it down, moving on.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that.
So the last Civil Twilight album, was that done in a similar way where it was based on demos that you had done, or was it more of a collaboration, or how, I mean, I guess, was there a similar or a different process in creating that album?
It was a bit of both. By that point, I'd become more experienced at making my own demos, and so a lot of it, and we had a long time to write for that record, and we had a new member in the band. He was playing guitar and keyboard, and so it was a new dynamic, and it needed some direction. And all of us at the time, except Rich, had pretty big drinking problems, and so we're trying to make it all work.
Oh, wow.
And so it was many hours of just, like, flailing around trying to get the organic feel, but we couldn't quite find it. Eventually we needed some direction, and so a lot of the songs were written in Nashville. There were a lot of demos that I'd made for that, hundreds of demos that I made for that, that we eventually filtered out. And
but you knew ahead of time you had to do demos. It wasn't like a 2 weeks.
No,
demos in 2 weeks.
Oh. Yeah, so it was like, we had a long time to write for it, so it was like, let's try to do the organic thing. So then we sit in the room for like 2 weeks playing, jamming, and then nothing came of it. So then we thought, let's try put some structure in. Then we put some structure in. I'd introduce a song. We'd try and nail the song down to exactly what the vision was, and it wouldn't work. So then we'd do that. You know, we'd do that for 2 weeks. It wouldn't work. So then we'd try something else for another month. That wouldn't work. It was this long, like, crazy process. And eventually, we had to put something down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's called Story of an Immigrant. Does that have, is that any connection to you guys moving over to the US from South Africa?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I don't know why that theme was prevalent for me at the time. I think I was, I must have been in my mind as I was thinking about what it means to be from somewhere else. I was chewing up the idea that we're all immigrants of some kind, and that we're all essentially, even if you are of a certain ethnicity and you are bound to a location, essentially you are linked to something. You are linked to somewhere else, you know. And I think it was just like trying to understand what is nationalism, what is patriotism, what are these terms that we throw around, and where, you know, how can we live outside of that? So I think I was wrestling with a lot of those ideas and missing home a lot. And So the songs that came out of that, a lot of heart in those songs. I think we did pretty well with that, but
yeah,
it was hard time. It was a hard one to make.
Will I join the team? The feeling.
And you'd mentioned that you guys were drinking pretty heavily at that point, and I know that led to some health issues for you. You had two seizures.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Yeah. Wow. I know that was the that's how it like came to head. Yeah, we'd been touring over the West Coast, opening for this band, and it was we had a break before like a week break before we went to the East Coast. I got back to Nashville and obviously kept the party going, and then and then one day I was, and one morning it was a Sunday. I was Sunday at the time, you know, Nashville Sunday liquor stores are closed. So I was like, okay, liquor stores closed now. I got to get some beer before I start to like, you know, freak out. And, but I missed the window. Yeah. I had like two seizures back to back from alcohol withdrawal. It's pretty crazy. Yeah. So it's, and then you're in the hospital, there's doctors reading your chart to you with zero judgment, just matter of fact, telling you what the state of your body's in.
Wow. You
know, for me, it was like, okay, it's time for a change. And that happened and the label imploded and the band dismantled all within a span of about 2 weeks, you know, it all came to a head.
That's incredible. I can't even imagine what you were going through at that point. I mean, everything in 2 weeks, that's just,
I know,
that's
crazy.
Rough. I know they say God doesn't give you more than you can handle, but that's a lot to handle.
Yeah. You know, it sounds a little crazier than it was. At the time it was so whirlwindy. It was just happening. And it actually felt very right. All of it felt like timely or something. It was interesting.
Oh, wow.
I mean, we had the band set, you know, we sat down as a band and decided to call it quits. And it was like the best. It was, we sat down, had coffee. We said, let's call this. And then we were like, it was just like insane relief. Just,
wow.
Just like came over us, and we were like able to sit there as friends for like 2 hours and just chat and parted ways. And that was that. It was like very simple, just uncomplicated. I mean, where to go from there? That was a bit of a, you know, what do I do now after? Yeah.
I'm assuming at that point you stopped drinking pretty soon after that.
Yeah. Then I was done. I mean,
did you have any future? Cause I know I've had people in the past who had similar issues, and there was a fear that your creativity kind of stemmed from that. I mean, was there any fear of that, of I'm going to stop drinking now? How am I going to write if I don't drink?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Massive. Yeah, man. That was huge. I didn't write anything for a few months. I didn't really go there. Yeah. I mean, the big one was performing. Like, if I was going to go and like do shows again, how the hell am I going to pull this off?
Right.
I hadn't done a sober show since I was like probably 15, 16.
Oh, wow. You
know? So I was like, how am I going to pull this off? And, so the first show I did actually, it was pretty crazy. I mean, it was, the first time I sang in public after being sober was the Hollywood Bowl.
Oh,
for the Chester Linkin Park thing. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So my wife and I, we decided to go and travel a little bit. You know, so it was, I think that was that time. Yeah. It was. So that was like, I mean, can I pull this off? You know, like,
right.
But when you, once you do it, you realize, it was so liberating to realize that I didn't need anything in my system for, you know, I could tap into what I really wanted to. I wanted to really be there. I mean, I always wanted to really be there, you know?
Yeah.
It's being there is what terrifies us, but that's where the life is, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And so, really being there, it's like, nobody, it doesn't matter how nervous you are. What's more important? It doesn't even matter if you fuck up. And more importantly, it's like being there.
Yeah.
For all of that, you know?
So how soon after the band broke up did you start writing solo material? And was that what ended up becoming the Belleville demos?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that was about a year later, I think. Yeah.
This is how it goes. This is how it goes.
I didn't do much I didn't perform. I was writing songs, but I'd always been writing songs and demoing stuff, but I didn't really think about putting anything out. And I didn't know what to do after that. Yeah, I put out the Belleville demos. I wrote that when my wife and I were in Paris, and I didn't really think much of it. I just like wanted to really go crazy. I wanted to try and see, if I wrote a record that I didn't have to play live, what would that sound like?
Oh, cool.
Yeah, if I could just put anything on there. So that's why there's tons of like brass and all kinds of tons of tracks. And it was a beautiful experiment. It was extremely liberating, you know, doing that on my own. And learning how to record things. That was the first thing I'd actually recorded and put out on my own. And
okay.
Hence the demo-like sound of it, you know. It's like I've got a little better at honing that since then, but I'm still learning, obviously. That was the beginning of it for me, yeah.
You're starting to write again. Was the thought always to be a solo artist, or was it to, or did you have any idea of maybe putting a band together, a different band, or was a solo artist always the focus for you? Or was there a focus?
I don't think there was, to be honest. And there still isn't really. It's
everything's still up in the air.
Yeah, man. I it's interesting. There was a lot of wrestle in me regarding what to do next. Naturally, I felt really insecure about being a solo artist and like what that means. I didn't think about being in a band again because it was too much. I didn't want to go there just yet. I think I was curious to see. I was curious to see what would happen if I decided to make things on my own, entirely on my own, if I thought, okay, if I can get the bravery to put things out on my own, to see how that feels. That's basically all it's been since. I mean, I don't really know. I don't really know how to define it for myself. It's just an experiment. And I feel more a deeper longing to collaborate with people because I think that's kind of where I came from was the collaboration, you know?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, your first band was Civil Twilight with your brother. You know, your whole history up until that band ended was as part of a band. So, I mean, that makes sense.
Yeah. So, who knows? I mean, that's the next thing, you know. I actually thought of that the other day. I got really excited about it. I was like, starting like a rock band again, like a three-piece rock band. I was like, what would that be like? That'd be really fun to do, man.
Yeah.
You know? We'll see.
That's kind of where Ethio is different. I mean, it's not rock. It's more electronic, which I guess doesn't necessarily exclude it from being a rock album, but it's a quieter album for the most part. I mean, it's you know, Modern Boy, Don't Ask Me Why. These are just awesome stuff. The Promise.
Swallowed all my pills, tried to ignore those credit card bills, made myself a dinner in the microwave, got down on my knees and I prayed and prayed, sang the national anthem out of tune. They said if I just keep going, all my dreams will
be. It's just you doing everything, right?
Yeah. I think, you know, the old, it's the sign of getting older. It's like, I just want to quiet down a little more.
I know that feeling.
Yeah. And after years and years of being, I mean, honestly, years of being on very loud stages with very loud drums and cymbals and everything, loud rooms and audiences. And like, I think I felt like I just wanted to like bring everything down a little bit. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's quiet time.
Yeah, man. Just a little bit of reflection, a little bit of breathing time, you know?
So is that what the albums are about? I mean, the Ethios and Nama, is it self-reflection? Is it you basically looking in on yourself? Or is it, I mean, are there themes to the albums?
Yeah, definitely. Well, I think Ethio was inspired. Well, it was a build up, but it essentially kind of came to head when I came back from being in overseas. So I think it was about 4 months we had been traveling throughout Europe, and I came back to the States, and I hadn't been away from the States that long since I had moved to the States. So okay. I felt a bit of objectivity when I landed at JFK, and I remember like standing in the passport line and feeling, you know, Trump had just been elected. And there was a sense of confusion and anger in the air. And I was like, what is, it's like this America by that point, by that stage was home, and it is home. And it was precious to me. I didn't like seeing it in the state, you know, yeah. I didn't like seeing it confused. I don't like seeing that kind of anger. And I was like, what is this? What is this? And I got home and I wanted to experiment. I didn't really purposely intend it to be this way, but eventually I started coming together where I wanted to, some started coming together walking down a street in an American neighborhood and sort of observing all the characters in each house. And,
oh, wow.
And so then, and then sort of seeing myself in them again, like it's, you know, so all songs are like, you know, whether they're no matter how, metaphoric they are all character based. Essentially, you have to draw from your own experience. Yeah,
true.
I think each character is, each song sort of represents a character, but which is representing somebody else's story, but it's essentially my story. Like essentially the way I feel about what it's like to live here.
Right.
Yeah. So it was kind of it was very fun to make, very interesting to make.
Did you make it before you had a label in place to put it out?
Yeah. So I made that. And
so you kind of had freedom. You didn't have any label going, all right, this has got to be this way, this has got to be this way.
Oh, it was absolute, just, yeah, whatever I wanted.
Oh, wow.
And then I met Todrick Spaulding. He just... I met him in LA. He started a label and he heard the record and really loved it and wanted to put it on his label. So I was like, that's incredible. Let's do it. But he, you know, Nama also came out on Sonic Ritual, which is his record label.
He's just like, he's not like a label, right? Sonic Ritual is just like, to me, they're a label, but my relationship with Todrick is like, he's got other complete trust. And he's like, whatever you want, whatever you make, we'll just put out. Like, he's incredible that way. So that's Nama awesome. Was made the same way. So it's like, all right, just do whatever you want to do. I think if I had sent him, like, you know, 6 minutes of silence and footsteps, he'd be like, yeah, sure, let's put it out.
That's awesome.
He's like, just full trust. It's quite amazing. Yeah.
So, okay, so that makes, I don't say makes sense, but it kind of, I heard that the new album was, you mixed it without actually listening to it.
Oh, so yeah. one of the tracks was, it's just funny. I was traveling again. I was in Nashville. They needed a master of the record of this one song. And, how did it go down? It was so funny. I didn't know how to. I had the master on my hard drive.
Okay.
But I didn't have a computer with me. So I couldn't mix it myself. So I had to go to a friend's house to mix it. So I plugged the hard drive into his system and the song came up on his computer. And then we started talking. And I hadn't seen him in a while and we started chit chatting. And then he had to go. And I said, okay, well, let's just do the song quick. And he's like, oh no, I already bounced it. It was like he just bounced it. And I looked at the file and I was like, I saw the, you know, the wave files and I was like, yeah, let's just
nothing weird here.
Let's just see. Yeah, it looks like it's the right time. So let's just send that. Like I'll know, you know, if I send it to someone to master it, they'll tell me if it's like, oh, there's no vocal on here or something.
Yeah. Oh, what song was that?
It was The Promise, but it was like a live version of The Promise.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Is that the one that ended up on the EP with the question mark?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the question mark one, which I thought was appropriate, you know?
Yeah, I like that. It took me a second. I was like, wait a second. There's an older, and then there's one with a question mark. And I'm like, okay.
I also like the idea of someone like trying to pronounce that. Like you know, so you got The Promise, which is like bold. It's like, you know, Bruce Springsteen, you know?
Right.
And then you got The Promise? Yeah. Like, question mark. I like the idea of somebody trying to work that out.
Hey, playing that on me. Next up is The Promise.
The Promise?
By Stephen David McKellar.
Yeah. I should just do everything with the question mark.
There you go. Yeah. Every album, every song is a question.
Yeah.
Or ellipses. Like you can use a combination of like ellipses or question marks.
So. Yeah, like. Yeah, like Prince became the symbol. You know, he's just a symbol. Now. I can just a question mark. That's like the Riddler.
There you go. All your songs are now just punctuation marks.
Yeah,
honestly, the new album. It's just punctuation. You get like a question mark. One song is an exclamation point. A schwa. You know.
Yeah. Why the hell not? That's what it's coming. It's what it's coming to now.
Hey, it'll set you apart.
Yeah.
the new album, Nama. It's. You know, it sounds like definitely a progression from Ethio. And I liked the EPs that came out. There's two EPs that came out ahead of the album with some songs that aren't on the album, which I really liked. The middle, I liked that a lot. That the creepy vocal effects and that simple guitar riff that goes on through the end. I love that.
Thanks, man. Yeah, that was my first time collaborating with an old friend of mine who, I mean, I met in Nashville, but he now lives in Tallahassee. And it was COVID vibes, you know, so I couldn't be in person. So I'd sent him some tracks to see. He's such a talented dude. And I didn't know what to expect really, but he sent me back yeah, I said, just send him a track and just do whatever you want on it. And just see what happens. And that's basically exactly what he laid down, like within a few hours, that riff, you know, and I was like, oh my gosh, spot on.
It is so good.
Yeah.
But one of the things I also like about the album is it's there's such a mix of feelings in it. I mean, it's a great album to listen to when you just kind of want to sit back and just listen to music for a while, you know, mm-hmm. not while you're doing anything else. You know, when you just want to sit back and just listen to music, this whole album is perfect for that.
Cool.
So was it tough to go and like, you know, we were talking earlier about how this is kind of an introspective album. Is it tough to write that way, to kind of, I guess, for lack of a better term, confront yourself, and especially over the last 2 years with the pandemic going on? Was it difficult to write music about yourself?
No. That's good. It sounds like... Nice. You made me think about it, like... nice. Especially that during that time. I mean, you got more time to reflect, you know?
Yeah.
I guess, and everyone was doing that, you know, at that time. I think, I mean, we're all the same. Like, our number one concern is ourselves. I mean, we think about ourselves the most, more than anybody else, you know, sadly enough.
Yeah.
That's just human nature. But I think the pandemic happening, sheesh, I mean, just so many emotions going on there. But I think I certainly felt homesick. Home is not the right term. I just felt like I hadn't been to Cape Town. I hadn't seen my family in a long time. I was going through some, and still am going through discovering my deeper identity, you know, who I really am, and and all that stuff. You know, when you're in the process of, when you're in the practice of journaling and asking yourself questions and writing, that's naturally going to come out in all the songs and all the music. And I feel like Numa's a little more hopeful, because that's what I was wanting to feel. You know, I wanted to feel a little more love in it. A little more simplistic love. So the themes are, yeah, just... they're about home. They're about, things that I love in life.
It's a great, like we were saying, introspective type of album with a lot of different themes, but it's not a bummer to listen to, you know. It's not one of those albums where you just, it's just sad all the way through. Mm-hmm. The first track, One and Zero, it's one of my favorites out in the album. It's beautiful. It's hypnotic. It's melancholy.
Chasing around like you're endless again. It's like you forgot the evolution. The fins are falling off. Now grow the feet.
But the whole album isn't that. I mean, you've got A Trillion Tiny Waves, I think, is my favorite song on the album. And that...
awesome. I think that's my favorite one, too.
I love it. It's got this skeletal beat, and then it just kind of builds into this swell at times. And I love the build in that song. It's great.
Thanks, man.
The treasure that pulls me. Carry me out to see.
it's very dense. So you got the skeletal stuff, and then it gets real dense. I love stuff like that.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I think that's a good example. That song is like talking about my love for music, essentially. I mean, it's very simple, you know. That's what I was wanting to feel, is just a simple gratefulness or something for what it is that I was doing, for the ability to be able to enjoy music. I mean, jeez, you already think about that. The role it plays in all of our lives, and how it helps us all to process things and to escape when you need to. I don't know. It's very,
Everybody's life has a soundtrack, and you're creating part of people's lives, parts of the soundtrack that they're going to remember. So that's a pretty amazing job to have.
I know, that is wild. Yeah. It's quite an honor.
People look back they think of a great memory. One of your songs could be attached to it. So that's one of the things that I've always loved about music is these attachments.
Man. I know, that's wild. And it keeps on giving. I mean, the more aged the song becomes, the more stories that attached to it, you know?
Oh, absolutely.
That's a wonderful thing. It's beautiful. I think that's when I think, if you're making things that resonate with you, with your truth, no matter where you are, it's going to have a place in the future. It's going to be undefined by the times, essentially. It's going to stand outside of trend, and it's going to live somewhere else. I think that's what we all really want to make and want to listen to. That's the power of it, eh? It's a wonderful thing.
And I love how the album ends with an awesome upbeat track, The Edge of the Garden. That's a great song. I love the way that the album ends with that. Wish there was a line that I could cross.
Thanks, man. Yeah.
The sequencing is awesome on it.
Oh, cool, cool.
So are you playing shows to support the album, or are you planning to? And is it going to be, would it be just solo Steven, or would you put a band together?
Oh, man. I haven't thought about that. I did a tour, and I put a group together, and my wife and I did a tour together, and it was a lot of fun. But I don't think I'll be doing that again, to be honest. I went on a national tour like that, club tours, and I did that tour, and I was like, man, I'm done with this.
Wow. Okay.
Totally open to like doing shows, but I think I'd want more control over the environment and find myself. Yeah. I'm 40, like in January. I'm a lot of my audience, if they're all up there with me or older, and it's like, here I am trying to bring them out to some, you know, some dingy club at 10 p.m. on a Wednesday to come see me play. I'm like, I don't want to do that to people. Yeah. You know, it's like, I just felt like this is not right. I don't want to have more control over this event that I'm putting on, that I'm basically hosting. I thought that
makes sense. But yeah, I will tell you one thing. I am in June, I will be 50, and I am one of the ones that will come out and see a band that I like on a Wednesday, an hour and a half away from my house. So,
Okay. One of those rare breeds. It's awesome.
Well, yeah. And you ever play in the Washington DC area, let me know and I'll bring my camera. So.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what'll happen next year. I'm planning some art shows and some more experimental stuff. I'll see how it all pans out. But no tours or shows planned right now.
I've kept you for quite a while today, and it's been awesome chatting with you. Where can people find the album? How can they pick it up and support you and follow you if you do some shows here and there, or whatever your next project happens to be, whether it's solo or a new band?
Yeah, well, the vinyl just came out like a few weeks ago. I haven't got a copy yet, but apparently it looks good.
The creator doesn't have a copy. And
apparently
yet.
It sounds good, yeah. So that's out. And if you go to my Instagram page, which is pretty much all I'm really operating on right now, if you go there, there's a link to get the vinyl, and there should be some links to get to listen to the record.
Okay.
And then I usually, if I'm doing something, an event wise, I usually post it on there.
Okay.
So that's a good place to go. I think I'm not really on anything else
okay.
right now. Yeah. Well, one is enough.
Yeah, I understand that one for sure.
Can't keep up.
Yeah. If I didn't have to be on so many for this to promote the podcast, I think I'd stick to Instagram myself.
Yeah.
Well, man, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for spending so much time with me, man. It's been awesome chatting with you.
It's been great, man. Thank you.